Okay, so now we have done the magnetic bead cleaning of our PCR products from PCR1. We also run from one to two gels, depending on how you want to do it. And now we are going to do PCR2. And I also talked a little bit about the preparations you need to do before PCR2, but I will mention it one more time just because I think it's very important to be quite familiar with this. And the most important thing is that you do the calculations according to one of our Excel forms that is in the Dropbox to find out the right amount of the different reagents in the master mix and in the reactions. But you also need to make some sort of system or spreadsheet to distribute all of the different forward and reverse primers, because this is very important for the downstream analysis and also for the sequencing company that does the sequencing for us. So here I have now prepared the master mix. And you see I'm sitting beside the UV cabinet. So I've already run the UV cabinet once already. So it's a clean space. I only have had the pipette tips inside, a pen, the PCR tubes that are empty, racks and so on, and also the water as well. But I have not had in the DNTPs, the reaction buffer, the polymerase, or other things that will be destroyed by the UV light. And for this master mix, it's a little bit different than the other. We still have the Q5 reaction buffer. We also still add the polymerase. We also add clean PCR grade water, and we add the DNTPs. So these things are similar and in the same concentrations, but the thing that differ from PCR1 is that we don't add the index primers. So here I have a tube or a Eppendorf with some reverse index primer, and I have here five tubes with forward index primers. So here I used the same reverse index primer for all of the samples, and this goes up to 20 samples. And then I use different forward index primers. So that's the forward that is kind of the big difference. And this is not added to the master mix, which I have made here. The next step to do this is to add the master mix into all of these PCR tubes. And here you can use a single pipette per row for one row, then change pipette, then another row, change pipette, and so on, because this has no DNA material inside. Then after that, it's very important to be very systematic and have a good system. As I showed you in the PCR1 episode, I use the pipette boxes as my map to where I'm working at the moment. And I strongly recommend that you do the same here as well. So take a look on that episode for seeing that system, because I add the primers after. And for the reverse primer that I will use for all of the samples here, then I can use, then I just use this tube, pipette, change tip, pipette, change tip, and go through all of them. And when I'm done, I move it a step down on the rack, for example, or whatever system that fits you. And then I start with the forward primers. And the forward primer should only go into one PCR tube, because this is kind of the unique part here. So this primer that is called 522F for forward goes only into the first tube. Then you move it down. And then you do it with the N523 in the second, move it down, and so on. So now I will very quickly just illustrate the process.
Huge.
So here since the total volume in the reaction should be 20, and we use 1 microliter of reverse primer and 1 microliter of forward primer and 2 microliters of the sample, then we need to add 16 microliter of master mix first. And here I open all the PCR tubes, get the tip, and open the master mix. Add it like this. And add it like this. And here, if you are maybe a little bit tired or you are not familiar with this process, then I strongly advise you to just close the lid you're done with. So the next one in line will be the one that is open. Like this. Close. Like this. Okay, so when you have done all the samples in one row, for example, or in two rows, then you can put the master mix back and take a new pipette tip. I like to do it one row at a time because then I can use the boxes or the pipettes in the box to see where I am. That's my preference. Okay, so now we have added the master mix to all the tubes, then it's the primers. And here we need to change pipettes, and we need to add only 1 microliter, which is not a big amount. So here, sometimes if you have many boxes of pipette tips laying around, it's very unnecessary to always take a new box. So you can just move the tips so you get a good system that actually reflects the system you have there. But now I'm going to kind of add the master mix, the reverse primer. So I open this, and here I do actually the same. I open all of them, so I'm prepared. Then I know, okay, this pipette tip here corresponds to this. Okay, so I take it out and add it in. Now I saw that I had too big of a volume. Then I need to change it to 1, which is always smart to double check. And I actually change tip just to be sure that I have no contamination. Okay, now it's only 1 microliter. Yeah. I add it there, get rid of the tip, follow the system again. Add it there, change the tip, and take this as a last example before we move on. And say that something happened here, that we had a disturbance or somebody asked you something or anything. Still, if you get like disturbed, you can now see where you are, that you have used 3 pipette tips and the 4th PCR tube is open, so you know that you are on 4, which is very smart. Okay. And when I'm done with up to 20 samples per, for example, reverse, then I place it down in the rack, so I know that, okay, this one has been used. And then it's the forward primers. And here I use a very similar system. I use the pipette tips in the box as a guideline to where I am, as a map. So here again, I open the tubes. Take the forward primer you need to that sample. And here it's very beneficial to have your computer standing or something, maybe some piece of paper, and that you have written your system down, that you know that this primer goes into this sample. So you can also look at that as a map. Okay, then you take a tip, suck up the required volume, put it into the tube, discard the tip. Okay, and now you close the forward primer because this is not going to be used in any other samples, and place it a step or two down on the rack. And then you take a new reverse primer, no, forward primer, I mean, I'm sorry. Place it, the amount into the tube, discard the tip, close up, move it down. New forward primer, check the data sheet you have maybe on the computer to see if it's the correct one. Look at the pipette tip map, double check that the volume is correct. Add it to the tube, close the lid, place it back. And then you do it for all of your samples. Okay. So a couple of things to keep in mind. If this example here only had very few samples or very 8 tubes in total, but if you're going to work with more samples, that's commonly the norm, then you can take into account to keep all of the reagents on ice. Especially the polymerase is very temperature sensitive and can be destroyed with prolonged exposure to higher temperature. So if you have more than, I would say, 20 samples, especially if you do it in duplicates or triplicates, then I would strongly recommend put it on ice, or if it's very warm, like we are approaching summer, if it's very warm inside, then I should also recommend that you should put it on ice. Then it's to put everything back into the designated freezers. One last thing is that we, as either students or employees here, we are not doing the aliquotation of the primers. The forward and reverse primers, this is something you have to ask for from the lab technician. Okay, last thing is to just take out these samples, spin them down at the vortexer that we have on the benches over there, and then we can go in the post-PCR room and add our PCR products or add our samples to the tubes, because that needs to happen in the post-PCR. Because this needs to be done in the pre-PCR. Okay, so we don't mix it.